instead of thanking God, sometimes instead of being discouraged about what didn't happen, you ought to praise God for what shouldn't happen. There are some of you actually should have took you out, the cancer should have took you out. Welcome to Legacy Center Church. Welcome to Legacy Center Church. I honor you. If there are any first time visitors, can you please stand to your feet and I might show? Any first time visitors, please stand to your feet.
Our worship team is having open auditions on Sunday, March 4th, so So all singers and musicians, please sign up at the Connect table. All men, we ask that you come out to Friday night men's prayer on March 9th at 7 p.m. here at Legacy Center Church. A reminder that our soul purge is on March 8, 2018, and it's every Thursday at 8 p.m. via webinar. As always, if you'd like to learn more about the church or current events going on within the church, please visit the Connect table located in the front of the church. Thank you and have a wonderful week in the Lord.
Thank you, sir. Hallelujah. You're praising and worshiping God. Nobody does. I am so glad that you all are here. I mean, I am just so pumped by what God is doing and just this love for us and this month, even as we learn the series, you know, love like Jesus. Love like Jesus is a lover. He is the lover. He is the standard of love. It loves us so much with a love that is unsearchable, a love that is just beautiful. Yeah, God is good. God is good, and He dances over us, and He loves us, and He smiles over us, and He laughs over us. It's just beautiful, you know, just to see the different aspects and the different, you know, aspects of God's love and His personality. And that's one of the things that, you know, it's very hard sometimes when we talk about the essence of God and the person of God. We forget, you know, how beautiful God's love is for us. Yeah. And the whole essence of this month's series is just to understand how God's love is, you know, what it really means to love like Jesus. And I know that we've had such an explosive time. And I don't know how to keep up with that. I just hope that you guys don't fall asleep while I teach, but I'm going to try to interject with some jokes here and there. Even if you don't find it funny, please, you know, just do me a favor. Let me know you're not sleeping. Amen. Amen. We are so excited about, you know, this month. We just finished our Destiny Marriage Academy. Amen. We spent a couple days with married couples from around the country. It was a select group of people who God wanted to be there. But it was wonderful. We learned about a lot. I just implore you, if you're married, make sure you even go ahead right now and put that on your calendar for next year. If you are single, start praying that by next year, this time next year, you have a reason to be there. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. We had a couple of singles who were there who learned so much. So much. It was really, really good. I was poured into. I thought the atmosphere was just good, just beautiful and fun, and the food was excellent too. I just wanted to add that there. Amen. 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 So we're talking about loving like Jesus, right? Loving like Jesus. Love like Jesus. And our theme chapter of verses are taken out from the book of 1 Corinthians 13. 1 Corinthians 13, 1 to the end, essentially. That whole chapter talks about love. And Apostle Paul did a beautiful job in just narrating love, almost like a poem, you know, talking about what love is. And what love isn't, you know, and just trying to exemplify, just trying to show us exactly what the nature of God's love is. And so I'm just going to go in, and I'm going to read. For some reason, my computer is just recording on me. So I'm going to pull up my scripture. Windows, you're updating on me. Amen. I love it like Jesus loves it. Even when it breaks my heart, I still love it. You know, just amen. So I read from the book of 1 Corinthians 13. And I want to just quickly go over the whole chapter because it's just, it's a wonderful expository book. If I speak in tongues of men and of angels, but I have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have a prophetic, if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but I have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all that I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burnt, but I have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. But we know in part, we prophesy in part. But when the perfect comes, the passion will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. But now we see in the mirror dimly. But then face to face, now I know in part. But I shall know him fully, even as I have been known, even as I have been fully known. So now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, but the greatest is love. That last verse is the key for next service, next Sunday. I just want to prepare your mind for it. I really think that God's going to speak to us with me next Sunday. But this Sunday, I just want to talk about, you know, the nature of love. I know that Dr. Faith last week did a wonderful job talking about some of the characteristics of love, yeah. You know, and that love is kind, right?
Yeah.
And love is kind. Love does not boast, doesn't envy. But if you look at the old narration of the old scripture in the book of 1 Corinthians 13, the first two verses do a good job at telling you that love supersedes everything.
Yeah.
It talks about the supremacy of love. That it supersedes everything. Everything. You know, one of the beauties about Apostle Paul is he was an educated man. He was a sound man, and he was also very spirit-filled. So he could combine aspects of philosophy and, you know, and spiritual understanding and make it beautiful and make it sound and reach, you know. And so that's some of the things that we're going to learn today. And so verse 1 to 2 talks about the supremacy of God's love. The supremacy of God's love. And how God's love oversees everything. It's better than anything you can ever taste or know. You know, we live in a time and age where some of the things that we consider as spiritual or some of the things that we consider as love is different from what they had considered love in those days. Mm-hmm. You know, this was the height of the move of God, you know, when God was moving in just awesome ways. And in those times when you spoke and in the tongue of angels and you spoke in tongues, people were like, whoa, that is God manifesting in that man or that woman, right? Because it was prime, right? That was what they experienced. So that was a thing that everybody looked to kind of gauge whether or not you were spirit-filled. And so Apostle Paul looked at it and said that, you know, you can prophesy, you know? You can dream dreams, you can see visions, you can talk about all of these great things, these beautiful things. But if you don't love God, it is nothing. If you don't love like Jesus, it is nothing. It says if you have faith so as to remove mountains, faith that will remove mountains, that's you know, the scripture says, you know, Jesus told us if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you would say to the mountain, you know, be moved from here and cast into the sea, and it will obey. So if you have enough faith to muster to do what even the apostles couldn't do, right? And you do not have faith, you have nothing. Sorry, you do not have love, you have nothing. Now, this is an interesting part, verse 3, and I want us to dwell on verse 3 because it really caught me off guard. And he says, if I give away all that I have, if I give away all that I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but I do not have love, I gain nothing. So it is possible for you to give for different reasons, some of which we're going to go into later on. But it's possible for you to give sacrificially, to live a life of sacrifice, to live a life of honor, to live a life of what's the word? Service. And still not love like the Father wants you to love. And if you do all of that, it's futile. Scripture says that you gain nothing. It says you gain nothing. You gain nothing. Now this, Apostle Paul said this because in those days there were believers who, you know, thought that if they gave their life up as martyrs, if they die, you know, for the work of God, or, you know, they give all that they have, they sell all that they have, and they give it to the work of God, but they do not really love the essence of love. And I know when we're talking about this, some people then ask, so what then is love? What then is love if I've given everything that I have? And I still don't love. What then is love? And we're going to talk about it. Love is the essence of God. Love is the essence of God. Scripture says that for God is love. We're not trying to emulate love. We're not trying to learn, you know, a series of steps or a series of do's and don'ts that qualify you to be loving or to be loving like God. That's not what we're trying to do. We're trying to absorb and we're trying to take in all that there is about God if we can. We're trying to have God, through us, show his love to the world. We're trying to yield ourselves to the leading of the Holy Spirit. We're trying to have God display his love, his character. Not just his love, his character, because you know that the nature of God is love. The nature of God is love. So when you express the love of God and you allow the love of God flow through you, what you are doing is you're expressing the nature of God. You are radiating the nature of God to the rest of the world. And so verse 3 says that even if I sell all that I have, remember Jesus said to the man who, you know, who came to him and said he wanted to follow him, he said, go, the rich young ruler, right? He says, go sell all that you have. All that you have and give to the poor. And come follow me. I think what Jesus was doing there was Jesus was giving him the first step of coming to knowing the Father. And so even if the young ruler had sold everything that he had and had come to Jesus, even if he had done that and he did not love, it still would be futile. It still would not have satisfied the reason for which Jesus existed. It wouldn't have satisfied the reason for which Jesus would have called him to himself. And so whatever we do, we need to understand that The height of love is not what you give. The height of love is not what you give. The height of love is not what you do. Because I know that sometimes, you know, we seem to have understood that, you know, that you just sometimes we overspend ourselves. And the interesting thing is because we don't have the pure love and pure motive of God, we don't understand sometimes that the actions that we consider love are not coming out from a wellspring of love. You know, they're coming out from different desires to give for different reasons. Different desires to give for different reasons. So one of the questions I ask them is, so if I do not know, for instance, you don't know that your love is not genuine, and you ask yourself, so why would I do all of this? And I have done this all my life. I have given, I have sold everything. Sometimes I even give half of what I earn because I love. And you're telling me that I don't love. I'm not saying you don't love. I'm saying you need to love like the Father loves. I'm saying you need to love like the Father loves. So some of the reasons why sometimes we don't love like the Father does is because we love for all different reasons. We love for several reasons. One of the reasons we love is because we love, why? To kind of please the Father. Some of us have been taught in church all our lives that if you do this, you do this, you do this, the Father will be pleased by you. The Father is not pleased by the actions or inactions that you do. The Father is pleased by you loving Him. Because if you love Him, you'll do His will. If you love Him, you'll do His commandments. If you love Him, it will overflow from that wellspring of love, will come out the nature, the very nature of who God is. So your actions are they're just byproduct of your love for the Father. The things that you do, places that you go to, or the gifts that you give, sacrifices that you make, all of those are a byproduct of your walk with the Father. And so one of the big reasons why people love a means or, you know, do and give themselves up to be burnt is because they're doing it out of duty. Misplaced duty. They think they're bearing the responsibility to do certain things. Which is beautiful because sons build the kingdom of God. So you giving and pouring out yourself to God is a beautiful thing. It's a wonderful thing. But that in itself does not qualify for love. That in itself does not replace the place of love. Another reason people do things of, you know, love and you know, miss it is because sometimes they do it to be seen. We do it to be seen. Whether consciously or unconsciously. Sometimes we grow up from, you know, families and backgrounds where, you know, you have to do things to get approval. You have to do things to get approval. They say, show yourself love, right? And so you make investments because you expect something back. You're making an investment in love because what? You're expecting something back. That is not the nature of God's love. Scripture says that while we were yet sinners, while we were yet sinners, while we were so far away from God, while we have separated ourselves from the nature of God, from the place of God, and all of that God has done and kept for us, He still sent His only begotten Son. He reached out for us. His love pursued us. His love pursued us. And caught up with us. And He did not leave us. He kept keeping pace with us. Overwhelmed us. Wow. And so when you love because you have to get something back. Or you love because you have to be seen. And oftentimes, I want to make this clear. Oftentimes, it's not something that's premeditated. Wow. It's not premeditated. It's not that we're all, you know, very heartless people or whatever. It's just the nature. It's the nature of man and how we've grown up and the experiences that we've learned and all of that. You just in your subconscious, you do things because sometimes you want love back. You want love back. And so you extend love because you expect to be loved. But the nature of God doesn't expect anything back when it loves. The nature of God gives and gives and gives and doesn't stop giving. And extends itself and doesn't stop giving. In verse 3, some translations of verse 3 says that if I give my life to be burnt and boast that I may boast in it. So how do you boast that you've given your life for it? I mean, if you look at the scripture talks about the Pharisee who went to the temple, right, to pray. And all of what he did were really applaudable things. But he didn't have to tell God he did it. So he was doing it because what? He wanted God to notice him. He wasn't doing it out of an overflow of his love for the Father. And so what the first thing he said when he came to the temple was, you know that I pay my tithe. And you know that I fast. And you know that I pray. And you know that I'm not like that one over there. And you know that I give alms to the poor. And you know that I travel to go pick my brother up when the car is broken to church. And you know that I don't talk back to people like that. And you know that I am good. But that's not the love that the Father is calling us to. Really, that is not the love the Father is calling us to. I mean, it's a beautiful thing to love God and to serve God out of everything that you have. But you cannot boast in your love for the Father. You cannot boast in the love you have for the Father. Because your love that you have for the Father, it's just, it doesn't in any way measure up. It doesn't in any way come close. It doesn't in any way compare to the just the sacrifice that God has done for you and for us. And so while some of us do that because, you know, we want to be seen, others do it because we want to, you know, want to get something back. Others do it because we're forming coalitions, especially, and we just quickly talk about this in the church. Because, yeah, we are the church, right? Yes. We are the church.
Right.
And it's so easy sometimes to extend love to one person and not to extend it to another person. It's easier to extend love to one person because you like them and you're friends with them and you know they got your back. But you don't extend the same love to the same person that you don't like their guts. That person you know hurts you. That person you know will cut you when they have a second. Your love is selective. It's not pure. There's a reason you prefer one person over the other. But if you look at it in itself, when you are spending time showering your love on this person that you love, you will genuinely believe that you love. And you do love. But it's not perfect love. No, the reason we're doing this, we're learning this, is because we want to have perfect love. And trust me, I am working on this too. I'm not telling you something that I've mastered yet. I am looking at myself like in a mirror, you know, daily working it out. Working it out and reminding yourself every day, why do you prefer that person to the other person? Why would you extend this amount of love to this person and not to this person? Why would you refuse this person love when you give all of it to this other person? Oftentimes we form collisions, especially in the church. And you're sure that this person will get your back if anything happens. And then when they don't, it breaks your heart. And then we form bands and groups and we form, you know, friends, you know, small groups, and that's fine. You would definitely have people that you would naturally gravitate, that you just gravitate towards. Right? But your love, your giving, your prayerfulness and all of that shouldn't be dependent just because you're attracted to one person or because you like the company of one person. And it's the fellowship of faith. And matter of fact, even outside. Outside, scripture says when Jesus exemplified his love, he did not really have a, he didn't prefer his disciples to sinners.
Yeah.
It would appear as though he does, because there is an interaction of the responsibility of the disciples to Jesus and his responsibility to them. So even though he spent more time with them, and even though he poured into them to build them and all of that, when you look at the way Jesus acted and the way Jesus lived this life, you will know that he didn't prefer the disciples to the sinners. He doesn't. And he goes everywhere, and the disciples try to stop the children from coming to him. And he said, no, let him come to me.
Right.
Let him come to me. And Zacchaeus, you know, Zacchaeus wanted to see the Father so much, and he says, I am going to dine in your house. He did not necessarily dine in the house of the Pharisees and all of that. So true love gives without expecting anything. True love gives without judgment. True love gives because it genuinely seeks to love. Another thing that we do when we love sometimes is because we like to feel needed. Some of us like to give. Some of us like to show love because it gives us a sense of security that the people depend on us. Or that we're able to show love in a particular way or in a sense. And so it makes us feel good about ourselves that we're able to love. But that's not the love that the Father is talking about.
Wow.
The Father is talking about the love that whether or not the person observes or not, whether or not your love is accepted or rejected, whether or not you are seen or not, you love consistently. You love consistently. And that's the kind of love that we're called to. And trust me, brothers and sisters, this is not something that you don't practice to love like that. And now people say you can. You don't practice to love like that. You keep your eyes on the Father. You let the Father, you let them prick your heart when you do the wrong things. You open up yourself to the Father and say, every day, daily, even in your actions, that this please you. I mean, I'm telling you this because it happens to me. The Holy Spirit convicts me. You cannot tell me that you don't have a preference. You cannot tell me that there's no bias between that action that you just did. And it's possible for us all to yield ourselves to the leading of the Holy Spirit. But we don't. Because we're considered in our own ways. And our understanding of love is what we look at. That's the first impulse that comes to our heart. And when we show love, it's based on how we've understood love all our lives. So I'm encouraging you that when you love, remember the book of 1 Corinthians 13. And it says that love is not envious. Love is not boastful. It's not prideful. Love is not envious. It's giving. It's not vaunted. It's not self-seeking. It's kind. It's patient. It's kind. It's patient. And this is the love that the world needs. This love we're talking about is not just for you to love the brother close to you or the brother next to you right here. It's not for us to have love so thick in this room that anybody who comes here just gets knocked down by the love of God. It's the love that we need to take to the rest of the world. It's the love that we need to show in our workplace. It's the love that we need to show to our neighbors. It's the love that we need to show on the streets. It's the love that we need to show wherever we go to. We need to let that love, that nature of God, begin to ring in out of us. It's a beautiful thing to talk about the love of God. You know, and what was just singing earlier on, I just heard God, you know this, it just came to my mind. Nobody loves like the Father. Just nobody does. But if we say we have the Father in us, if we say we have the Holy Spirit in us, if we say that the Holy Spirit through us does all things, how come we don't love like He does? How come we don't love like the Father loves? So we have to unlearn what we know about love. We have to unlearn what we understand about love. And understand that loving is not seeking approval. Loving is not loving with an agenda. Loving is not just an attraction. Loving is not favoritism. Loving is not loving somebody because you want something back and then forming bands and collisions and all of that. Loving is just really genuinely just loving people whether they deserve it or not. Yeah. It has been kind in love. It has been patient in love. It has been long-suffering in love. Yeah. It does not envy. It's not prideful. It is humble in humility. Now, I ask a question because Apostle Paul started chapter 13 by speaking about such lofty spiritual gifts. Gifts that we all covet. Gifts that he even instructs us to covet. It's a coveted gift of prophecy. So it's a good thing to prophesy. It's a good thing to speak in tongues, right? You build up yourself, right, in your own language. All of those are beautiful things. But they do not exhaust, but they don't even come close. They do not even come close to the love of the Father and the love of God. So the question then is, why should we seek love above all of this? Because essentially what Apostle Paul is trying to tell us is that we should seek love above sacrifice. And we should seek love above what? Gifts of the Spirit, right? And we should seek love above what? Above the flamboyance of everything else. Yeah. Even in today's world, it will be somebody speaking to a crowd of a 40,000 capacity church, or you know, singing and having, you know, Grammy nominations, or whatever the height of the, you know, our achievements today is, whatever it is that gives us the most accomplishments, that gives us an idea and a sense that we're close to God, all of those in themselves are futile without the love of God. They are futile without the love of God. Now, why should we then seek the love of God above all of this? The very first reason is because all of the things that we seek, all the things that Apostle Paul enumerated in the book of 1 Corinthians 13, the first two verses, all of those are just
gifts. And they are the handiwork, they are manifestation of the Father. They are not the Father's nature. So those are two different things. And it's often missed. I mean, I know this is a sober reflection, this is a time for us to just like really think. But if you go to the church, if you go to churches anywhere, and you want to tell about the presence of God, ask the average person, how can you tell the presence of God? They'll tell you, well, there was healing in the room, right? There was signs and wonders, there were prophecies in the room. Seldom the people say there was the love of the Father in the room. It takes somebody who is deep in revelation and understanding to say that I felt the Father's love when I was in that room. Because we have our perspectives on the wrong things. We have our eyes fixed on the things that captivate us. Prophecies captivate us. It is beautiful. It gives us that hint of the future. Speaking in tongues is good. I mean, it builds itself. I mean, you can tell when somebody is speaking in tongues and they have the unction of the Holy Spirit. But the unction of the Holy Spirit rests on people. It leaves. The one thing that never leaves you is the nature of God. The one thing that never leaves you is the presence of God Himself. So God can lay, He can come over somebody to fulfill His will. Or if they yield themselves to God in certain times and seasons, God will move. He's no respecter of anybody. It doesn't take away the gift that He has given. He has freely given us gifts. The only thing He hasn't really, I mean, He's given to us gifts, are the gifts He gives us gifts without repentance. But the presence of God and the nature of God is not something that you just get. You have to covet it. You have to want it. And so the reason why we should seek love above spiritual gifts is because love exemplifies the nature of God. When I'm talking about love, I'm not talking about just actions. I'm not talking about one or two actions. I'm not talking about just loving for somebody or giving gifts or praying for them. All of those are what? Options of love. Mm-hmm. Love is how you regard them. Mm-hmm. How you think about them.
Wow.
Your pursuit of them. That you want, even if you're not the person that is giving it to them, you want them to be good. You want them to have favor. You want them to do well. You want them. It breaks your heart when you see them go astray.
Yeah.
It doesn't give you a sense of belonging or a sense of pride or a sense of joy that somebody, because this there is a converse point of what I said earlier on. That sometimes we give because why? It makes us feel needed. And so sometimes people rejoice when there is a need for them to show up. And then when somebody lacks something, they're rejoicing that because they show up like what? Like a savior and a hero. The shining armor. That's not who you are. When somebody, no matter how much you have to help, when somebody hurts, it shouldn't hurt you. The heart of the Father hurts when we hurt. And He has everything within His reach. He has everything to correct every hill that we're going through. But His experience with us, it's not just somebody who gives because it makes Him feel needed. His experience is because He loves us genuinely. And so when we hurt, it hurts Him. Now the gifts and the sacrifice and all of this that we talk about, it flows out of the nature of God. So you can have parts of it. You can have parts of it, or you can go for the full package. And the interesting thing is, even Apostle Paul, with such eloquent revelation, with such, you know, what such wonderful revelation and all of that, he said, I know in part. All of what we're talking about now is the in part. And you got to understand how this has freed me up so much. And I don't even get into certain theological arguments with people. Because you can argue for years. You can go study a PhD in every subsection of theology. And you still know in part. And you still know in part. Jesus himself. When Jesus talked to people, when he dealt with the poor, he didn't bash them with deep knowledge and truth. Those are good things. He was moved with compassion. He talked about reconciling them back to the Father. But we live in a time and age where we have left the most basic things, the things that change the world, the love of the Father. And we talk about deep mysteries, which is good. But I would be impressed if you knew it all. I would be impressed if your revelation and your prophecies and your tongues are complete.
Come on now.
But it isn't.
Right.
So why are you puffed up?
Come on now.
Why am I puffed up?
Exactly.
No, really, why are we puffed up?
Right.
If all we see is just like seeing in a mirror dimly. We have an idea of it. We have an inclination. But we don't see the full picture. Why then are we puffed up? Why did we bash somebody who, yes, we have better understanding than them. But we bash them with our understanding that, by the way, is just progressive. I was supposed to say that when I was a child, I saw like a child. I thought like a child. I saw like a child. Now I am becoming a man, right? But that is a progression, because at the time he said it, he wasn't an aged man. He was in his prime. So there was yet more wisdom for him to get. So even what he said in this wasn't the fullness of what he understood God to be. So there was a progression of understanding. If your knowledge, if your revelation does not pull people to the fire.
That's it. I don't care how the reason why.
Every time you open your mouth to say something, it doesn't bring somebody to the knowledge of God. It is all futile. You can captivate thousands of people. You can keep a whole crowd, a whole stadium full of people captivated. It does nothing in the presence of God. Look at Jesus when Jesus thought. Everything he said was in parables. He made it simple. Somebody said if Jesus lived in our time, he'd probably be like Steven Spielberg. Because he tells stories. He's a narrator. He's always trying to break the big things down as simple truth. So simple that the very educated people could not understand it. They got irritated by it. The Pharisees were expecting. And interestingly, Jesus just does things conversely. When he was 13, a child, he bamboozled them with the word. He knocked them out back right and center with the word, right? And he got older. And they were expecting deeper revelation. And he just stepped it down. He just stepped it down. Another reason why we seek the love of God and the love of Jesus, and the reason why we want to love like the Father, is because all of these gifts will cease. All of these gifts will pass away. When you go to heaven, there will be no need for prophecies. There will be no need for prophecies. Because just looking at the presence of God, it suffices all in all. Everything you know. Scripture says that when we meet him, just in the twinkling of an eye, once you meet him, that encounter changes everything. That one encounter changes everything. There will be no need for prophecy. And so if there's something more lasting, if there's something more, you know, something that would not tarnish, it's the nature of God.
Yeah.
Note, I didn't just say loving like Jesus, because we do that, and you know, sometimes we want to love. We learn so hard how to love, and we beat and knock ourselves down. That's not what I'm talking about. I am saying that you love like the Father. And how do you love like the Father? You let the nature of God ooze out of you.
That's right.
I mean, just let the nature of God come over you. possible. It is possible. If you yield yourself to the nature of God, when you do things, I mean, I will tell you, but I do feel it. And I talk based on experience. I don't tell you what I don't do because that's not my job. My job is to lead based on what I've experienced. And you will feel it. You will feel the nature of it. You will feel the tug of God. You may not yield to it because you're mad in that moment. But you know.
Absolutely.
You may be prideful. Right? You may be resentful. You may, over time, have ignored the voice of God so much that you don't even know that it's there, but it's there.
Yeah.
It beckons on you. It beckons on you when you pass up with Aaron by somebody who wouldn't even know you, who needs a word of encouragement. Don't save it for just the church. For people who know you and people who will reckon with your gift. Sow it where you may never ever meet that person anymore.
That's right.
Sow it without an expectation to get something back. Sow it with the genuine heart to, you know, to radiate the love of the Father to them.
That's it.
Alex, you've got too quiet in here. Yeah. But I just wanted to share this. That's just all I got for today. I know we're going to be transitioning into the Holy Communion, but I really, really want to encourage us. I want to encourage us because I don't want us to hear this sermon as one of those sermons that you come into and then you forget about it come Monday and Tuesday. Because I want you to just be introspective. Go on your timeline on Facebook. Just be introspective. Go on your timeline on Facebook today and just sit back. And just scroll down. And just see what people talk about the nature of God.
Absolutely.
Or what people talk about, you know, whatever. They're very beautiful things. Very beautiful things that are so far away from the point.
Right.
But I just wish that we can each tug somebody close and say, sir, let's keep our eyes focused on the fact. All things are beautiful. But let's just keep our eyes focused on the fact. And let's love like Jesus loves. Let's rend our hearts. Let's let the Father break our heart for what breaks his.
Yes.
I don't understand how we can live in a, without going into politics, we can live in a country or a nation where kids die. And there's mass shootings. And there are different things. I don't want to pick that up because I don't want anybody to feel like I have a political affiliation. But we cannot live in a nation where we see young people die.
Mm-hmm.
Destinies are twilight.
Yeah.
And all we have to say is that our forefathers knew the reason why the signed the Second Amendment. Which I have nothing against the Second Amendment.
Right.
I think it's a beautiful thing, if you can. But we cannot say that if we all wanted to resolve this issue, let us see this house as one house. Let's say that we are all one family, not your family versus my family.
Right,
no,
right,
your
right,
belief
right.
versus my belief. We all live in one house.
Right.
And we all own guns in that house.
Yeah.
And we know that somebody is crazy in that house.
Right.
Let's look at it this way. We all live in one house. We have weapons in the house, which I think we should have weapons in the house. But we have crazy people in the house.
Yeah.
Would you genuinely make arguments?
Come on.
Like mental health needs to be improved on without also checking, without loving on that person who is broken. Without like really loving on that person who is broken. Politicians talk about mental health victims and all the people. How many of them really can hug on somebody who is really crazy?
Absolutely.
I don't mean giving them medications.
Right.
How many of you can really go and hug on somebody who's crazy?
That's it.
Yes.
Or you think they can't feel love? Or you think they don't know love? They know that we all talk. They know that we all argue. They know that we see things based on our lenses, from our perspectives. And we dissociate from issues.
Uh-huh.
because it's not in your house.
Yeah.
And your zip code will not have that problem. And so it's not your issue. And so you can reduce it to very sensible arguments. We need better mental health, whatever. What are you doing?
That's exactly right.
What are you doing apart from the medications and all the funds? What are you doing to go hug and give identity and love to somebody who has a mental issue? How about we all try it? We seek for somebody in our neighborhood, in our street, in the schools where we live. A child we know is troubled.
Right.
We have a lot of people working in social work here.
Yeah.
Let's ask them, how can you help us reach those people and just spend time? Sometimes just sit by them.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
You don't need to teach them anything. You don't need to. Just sit with them for an hour.
That's it.
And just place your hands over their shoulder.
Yep. Yeah.
And pray.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
we talk the big game.
Come on.
But we do nothing. And we'll impress ourselves, we'll impress the Father.
Yeah.
Let's stand up and just spend some time.
Self-consumed, we're so fixated on what potential.
else. For not becoming like the Father, for not yielding ourselves to your love, for not just opening up ourselves to just let the love of the Father just blow over us and cover us, God. So that we may be patient and loving and meek and kind and not envious and not boastful, not prideful and giving. And so, Lord, we cry out today for repentance, God. And we turn our eyes away from the love that we've always known. And we keep our eyes fixed on your nature. We keep our eyes fixed on your love. We keep our eyes fixed on who you are. We keep our eyes fixed on who you are, God, that you're through us, God. Through us, you may reveal your love to the world. Through us, you may reiterate your love to the world. We want to be more like you, Jesus. We want to be more like you, Father. We want to be more like you, Jesus. We want to be more like you. Keep our eyes fixed upon you, God. Keep our eyes fixed upon you, and Lord, there are beautiful things, God, that you're proud of, that you've gifted us, God. Of eloquence and all the things that you've blessed us with, God. We know that it doesn't repent your heart to give us those gifts. But those gifts are by the way. They are just by the way. They're not in itself what you want us to be. And so, Lord, we peel up those layers, God, over our lives. Layers of expectations, God. Layers of expectations, God, even understandings that we have come to understand and we've come to accept as a standard of love. And we feel it all over us. We just take it off, God. We take on your nature. We take on your nature. We take on your nature, Father. 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 We want to be more like you. We just want to be lovers, God. We just want to love you, God. We want to love you, God. We want to love the world like you love the world. Scripture says that you love the world, not just the saved. You do not just love the saved. You love the whole world and you gave your begotten Son that while we were yet sinners, that you will kindle the love. You will kindle our love for the world. You will kindle our love for the broken, for the lost. Not just for our own. Not just for people who look like us. Not just for brothers and sisters in the fellowship, God. You will kindle our love for the lost, God. For the rejected, God. For the downtrodden, God. You will kindle our love for the hopeless, God. You will kindle our love for the sinners, God. You will kindle our love for the lost, God. And that you will make us lovers, God. Lovers of the world, lovers of the people, God. Lovers of the world, not to conform to the world. But to love the world to a change. To love the world to be more like you, God. To be the world to a better understanding of who you are through love. Let your love just fill this whole atmosphere, God. Let your love just fill us up. Let it fill us up. We open up, Lord, and we drink of your love. We drink of your presence. Of your nature, we drink of who you are, and we say, Lord, come, God, come, Father, come, come, Holy Spirit. We do not want a move of healing, God. Right now, we do not want a move of tongues, God. We do not want a move of gifts. We want a move of your nature. We want a move of your presence, because out of it flows, God. Out of it flows, yes. Out of it flows. But out of your nature, out of your presence flows the excess, God. Excess of your gifts. Gifts flow out of you. It just comes out, it oozes out. And so, Lord, let us be people, Lord, who are sold for your nature. Who are sold to love like the Father loved. Beautiful. There's nothing wrong in that. But one of the things he asked us to do was to remember his body and his blood. And as often as we do this, and we take this testament in his name, that we remember the ultimate sacrifice that he paid for us. And another thing that is indeed he asks us to do is to love. Is to love. Is to love. So if you open, if you peel off the film over the bread,
Saturday registration is still open and it's free and open at